Okay, Dr. Mazzola, are you there?
Yes, just a moment, please. Okay.
Il giorno dopo,
it's me.
Hello, hello, hello.
La mattina, commissaria, allora.
Sorry. Ah, sorry, there is a... Okay. Okay. So good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome all of you to this afternoon's ceremony for the awarding the 2021 Dirac Medal and Prize. As all of you here know, Dirac was one of the all-time greats in theoretical physics and also a good friend of the center. He visited ICTP on a number of occasions. And we even have a Scala Dirac named after him. And the prize is in his honor, given to major breakthroughs in theoretical physics. And this year's Dirac Medal, we are very happy that Dirac medalists are Alessandra Buonanno from Max Planck Institute in Germany, Thibault Damour, from Institut des Hautes Études Scientifiques in France, Franz Pretorius from Princeton University in the US, and Saul Tucholsky from Caltech and Cornell University in the US. Saul is joining us online, and the other three Dirac medalists are here. I'm also very happy that Dr. Michele Mazzola is joining us here from Rome, representing the Director General Consoli from the Ministry of Research. ICTP is very grateful. As you probably know, ICTP is governed by a tripartite agreement between the Government of Italy, International Atomic Energy Agency, and UNESCO. And we are very grateful for the unwavering support of the Italian government and for hosting us here. As a scientific, to give the scientific introduction to the winners of the Dirac Medal this year, we invited Professor Kip Thorne from Caltech, who received the 2017 Nobel Prize. And I'm very glad that Kip has agreed to join us on this very important occasion. And the medal has been given for establishing the predicted properties of gravitational waves in the curvature of space-time produced when stars or black holes spiral together and merge. This achievement was essential for the LIGO detection of gravitational waves from these energetic astronomical events. And the consistency of theory and observation is an impressive check of the accuracy of the general theory of relativity. And I think it's really truly a remarkable achievement of, let's say, the 21st century physics, that these extraordinary events were detected, the two black holes merging, for which the Nobel Prize was awarded. But the theoretical work of this year's Dirac medalist was essential for interpreting the observations from the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, which is an unusually subtle experiment. And to really understand what it is that we are seeing, one needs detailed waveforms about what it is that you expect. And I think it's really a marvelous tribute to the remarkable power of our theoretical understanding of nature, that by solving the Einstein's equations, which were written 100 years ago, we are able to predict how the waves will look like. So, and the work of the this year's Dirac medalist was absolutely essential for of our ability to compute from these equations. So it has been said actually that this really opens a new era in astronomy, rather like Galileo's telescope, that it's a new eye, a new window onto the universe. But unlike Galileo's telescope, which human eye can immediately process and see the images of, the signal that we get from this LIGO detector is something that requires this very abstract processing via the Einstein's equation. And this is what the medal is about. And I think if you look at the history, we were actually just discussing before this ceremony, the very interesting history of the discovery of the gravitational waves. It's a truly remarkable, the ups and downs and the skepticism in the community, even about the existence of black holes, the possibility of detecting it, and the role of the scientific community as a whole. I mean, I think it's really a collaboration of between analytical methods, numerical methods, mathematical relativists, observational breakthroughs, and also many inspiring sort of guiding lights, putting, forcing the community to say that this problem is important, despite oftentimes quite serious hesitations and the criticisms from the rest of the community. And Kip Thorne is certainly one of the people, I think, therefore, he's most ideally suited to tell us a bit about this very interesting history and the path to the discovery of the gravitational waves and the contributions of the Dirac medalists. So I'm very happy that Kip is here to tell us about it. So I will give now the floor to Dr. Michele Mazzola for the remarks as a representative of the government of Italy. Dr. Mazzola.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. Estimated Chairman, members of the ICTP, dear all, let me first greet the ICTP Director Adish Babrakar, with the organizer of this special event, and all of you in the audience on behalf of Gianluigi Consoli, General Director of the Internationalization Department of the Ministry of the University and Research in Italy. Thank you for allowing the ministry to contribute to this important ceremony to appoint this edition of the Dirac Medal. The ministry has always appreciated the excellent scientific performances of the ICTP, a distinguished international center that we are honored to host in our country, especially in this beautiful city of Trieste. ICTP contributes to Italy and Trieste as a reference for science in Europe and worldwide. I am particularly sorry not to be in this beautiful city in person, but unfortunately, as you know, it is a very intense work period in Italy, especially for the project of PNRR that you know. ICTP distinguished activities is based not only on the well-recognized worldwide high-level formation and the cross-fertilization among different research fields, but also on pricing the squeeze distinguished scientific science 1985 for assigning the Dirac Medal. We are here to give the person of the Dirac Medal 2021 to Alessandra Buonanno, Thibault Damour, Franz Pretorius, who won this prize with Sol Teokorskis, I'm sorry for my pronunciation of this surname, who will be connected online for their outstanding theoretical contribution to the understanding of the gravitation. They significantly contributed to writing such a beautiful page of physics and human knowledge. I hope the audience and the other winners allow me to congratulate Alessandra Buonanno more especially. She represents one more extraordinary example of what our school and university can contribute to forming. She got her master's and doctorate degrees in Pisa, is my city, or not, confirming that Italian high-level information is of value. She has then chosen to work between France, Swiss, Germany, and the USA. We understand that this fits very well within intrinsic international character of science. So we're represented here at ICTP. But we hope Alessandra still feels her Italian roots. Let me also stress that our country has a historical and actual weakness in the field of the gravitational wave detections. It started in the late 50s under Eduardo Amaldi Puch with the cryogenic antennas. Then it continued with Adalberto Giazzotto, one of the inspiring founders of interferometric detection in Pisa. Actually, during the time Alessandra was studying there, maybe he was inspiring her too. We hope it will continue if our country will host as a very interesting the third generation high-sun telescope detector in SOS and Aptos, Sardinia. We hope that this were possible. SOS and Aptos region shows an exceptional low seismic and anthropic noise and is an ideal territory to host such an ambitious project as ET. We then count on Alessandra and our systematic colleagues to continue this necessary and fruitful collaboration between theorists and experimentalists on such a fascinating research team, hopefully helping our country to be at the forefront of the gravitational science. Therefore, I wish you a successful event. And again, allow our personal and institutional congratulations to the Dirac Medalists 2021. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mazzola. I now request Professor Kip Thorne to say a few words. You may remember, actually, he visited ICTP about 3 years ago. He gave a beautiful colloquium on this topic. So I request him to give an introduction to the pioneering contributions of the 2021 medalists.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here with you today. I wish I could be there in person. It was not possible. So I'm remote from the United States. Let me share my screen with you. Let me make sure I get the right one. And then I'm going to bring up my slides. Okay. Can you see those slides? Okay. I trust. Okay. So, according to the laws of physics, there are just two types of waves that can be produced in the distant universe and travel across the great reaches of intergalactic space to Earth, bringing us information about what's far away: electromagnetic waves and gravitational waves. It was Galileo, of course, 400 years ago, who built a small optical telescope, pointed it at Jupiter, discovered Jupiter's four largest moons, and in the process created modern instrument-based electromagnetic astronomy. It was LIGO on September 14, 2015, with data analysis jointly from the LIGO collaboration and the Virgo collaboration that discovered gravitational waves from colliding black holes and thereby created gravitational wave astronomy. It was very important in developing the foundations for this that we know already very early on, what the expected strongest sources of gravitational waves would be. And it was that knowledge then that underpinned the work of our medallists. It became clear by about 1980 that the strongest sources would be binary neutron stars, two neutron stars orbiting each other, spiraling together as they emit gravitational waves, colliding and merging, or binary black holes, neutron stars made, of course, from almost pure nuclear matter, the binary black holes made from pure warped space and time, that spiraled together, merged and collided, and produced a great burst of gravitational waves. And that, of course, was what was seen. Now, there were three components of R&D that were required in order to have the great success of LIGO. First, the experiment, a gravitational wave interferometer, largely conceived by Ray Weiss at MIT, which consisted of two mirrors that hang from overhead supports 4 kilometers apart, along one arm of an L and two similar mirrors along the other arm of an L. When the gravitational waves came by, they would push these mirrors apart while squeezing those together. Then at the next half cycle, push these apart while squeezing those together. And those motions, the difference in changing difference in arm length was monitored using laser interferometry. The R&D for these interferometers began in 1972. By 1987, the LIGO project was initiated in the United States, and not long thereafter, the Virgo project initiated as a French-Italian collaboration. And in 1994, the construction of the LIGO interferometers began, and 21 years later, the first detection of gravitational waves. The second component of R&D that was required was a knowledge of the waveforms to feed into data analysis. The gravitational waveform is a plot of the gravitational wave strain, which is the fractional change in arm length in the interferometer as a function of time. And plotting up then is a stretch, plotting down is a squeeze of the arm, and the oscillatory stretching and squeezing is the gravitational waveform that we very much needed in order to be able to feed into the data analysis for searching for the gravitational waves in the gravity wave interferometer data. In 1989, a decision was made by the LIGO director that the waveform computations would be carried out outside of the LIGO project. This decision was motivated to a great degree by an underappreciation of how crucial the waveforms would be and how extremely difficult it would be to compute them. A few days ago, Barry Barish, the LIGO director most responsible for LIGO's success, said to me how very lucky we were that despite the lack of close coordination with the LIGO project, waveforms were ready in time for LIGO's first detection of gravitational waves. Actually, it wasn't luck. It was due to the dedication, the cleverness, and the perseverance of our 4 Dirac medalists and their collaborators. Evolution of a binary black hole or binary neutron star consists of 3 stages. The first stage, the early stage, the two objects orbit around each other, gradually spiraling together as they emit gravitational waves, which carry off orbital energy. The collision and merger of the two objects and the ring down of the final object, sort of like the ringing of a bell. In the 1980s, as we were planning for LIGO, I speculated as to what the waveforms would be in this sort of a cartoon, and in-spiral waveforms, which we already by then had some understanding of what they would be. the ring down waveforms at the end and the merger waveforms, which I thought and hoped would be rather complex. And the merger waveforms could only be carried out, deduced from supercomputer simulations, as we believed at that time. The merger and the ring down for a binary black binary neutron star occur at gravitational wave frequencies that are so high, above 1 kilohertz, that the LIGO noise is bad there. And there's not much hope, at least there was not in that era, of actually seeing those waves. So the R&D for the binary neutron stars focused on the in-spiral waves. But the binary black holes at the gravitational, the merger and ring down were at gravitational wave frequencies we expected below 1 kilohertz, where the noise is low. So the focus for binary black holes was on all three stages, and that was where almost all of the energy went in the early years of planning for LIGO and Virgo gravity wave observations. The ring down waveforms were computed using a black hole, what's called black hole perturbation theory. By 1972, we knew that quiescent black holes are described by Roy Kerr's solution of the Einstein field equations. And in that year, 1972, the same year as Ray Weiss initiated R&D for these interferometers, Saul Tucholsky, as a graduate student at Caltech, deduced the equations for weak perturbations of black holes and brought them into a simple, easily usable form. This was actually quite a tour de force. A number of other people were struggling to do this. And many of us had begun to suspect that this would not be possible. But in fact, he succeeded. And he thereby initiated, and he, working together with his fellow student, Bill Press, did much of this early work, initiated the study of the quasi-normal modes of oscillation of a black hole, that is the ring down waves that LIGO and Virgo would ultimately see. And also a study of the waves from a small body, for example, a small black hole orbiting a large black hole, which would also play an important role in the work I'll describe today. The in-spiral waves, the waveforms, were computed by the post-Newtonian approximation. The basic idea was to expand the metric of space-time and Einstein's equations in powers of the Newtonian gravitational potential, which is of the same magnitude as the orbital speed squared. At first order in this expansion, one has Newton's theory of gravity. Second order is what was called the first post-Newtonian order. At order 2.5, one saw for the first time the effects of radiation reaction back on the source, and so forth, higher and higher orders, a variety of new physical effects and new influences on the waveforms. Building on earlier work of Einstein, Chandrasekhar, and others, Thibault Damour led a successful major effort in the 1980s and 90s to carry the expansion to high enough order to meet LIGO's future needs. To achieve this, Damour reformulated the post-Newtonian expansion, and he developed ways to resum the expansion so as to make it more accurate. This work was tremendously complex, with pitfalls that Damour circumvented elegantly. Major contributions were also made by Damour's former student, Luc Blanchet, and by Bala Iyer, Gerhard Schaefer, and others. The merger waveforms we expected to be computed from numerical relativity simulations of the binary black holes. These simulations are extremely difficult. One reason is that one must evolve black holes, which themselves are made from warped space-time, as they move through space with time passing. And so just think about that and how difficult and different from any other computational work that had been done before this must have been. And the merger creates, in fact, a wild storm in the shape of space and time and the rate of flow of time in the vicinity of the black hole horizon, which had to be dealt with. The early history of numerical relativity began in 1959 with foundations laid in John Wheeler's Princeton University group by Charles Misner, Richard Lindquist, and Susan Hahn. And then in the 1960s and 70s, Bryce DeWitt spearheaded and Larry definitely had success in computing the head-on collisions of non-spinning black holes. The 1980s and 90s were devoted to developing techniques for evolving, orbiting, colliding black holes. And these techniques were developed by many people, but already finally by 1999, nobody had succeeded in putting all these techniques together so as to evolve even non-spinning black holes through even just one orbit around each other. There was great frustration, and I was beginning to be worried as to whether or not the numerical relativity would succeed. In 1999, Alessandra Buonanno and Thibault, Damour came to the rescue. They invented a method called the effective one-body method, a method for computing the waveforms from inspiraling and merging binaries. In this method, they re-expressed the orbital motion of non-spinning binary black holes in terms of the motion of a particle around a spherical central body. The metric of the central body was determined by the binary black hole's mass ratio in a very clever way that was informed by a resummed post-Newtonian expansion of the binary black hole orbit. From this EOB model, Buonanno and Damour computed the analytic binary black hole in spiral waveform. And then with the aid of Tucholsky's perturbation methods, they deduced the approximate analytical waveform for the binary black hole's very late in spiral, its inward plunge, its collision, its merger, its vibrational ring down. The approximate merger waveform was very simple, amazingly, a very smooth transition for in spiral to ring down, not at all what I had hoped for and expected. And we now know, I think, in retrospect, that this was because the wild oscillations of space and time were occurring very near the horizon, and the gravitational waves from those were largely going down the black hole, the merged black hole, and not coming off for us to see, unfortunately. By the early 2000s, approximately 15 numerical relativity research groups were trying to simulate the binary black hole in spiral merger and ring down. These simulations were absolutely essential because we did not know how accurate the approximate EOB waveforms were. And still in the early 2000s, not a single orbit had been simulated successfully. In 2005, Franz Pretorius, a postdoc at Caltech, broke the logjam working alone with a code that he wrote largely single-handedly, though borrowing key ideas from others. Franz's brilliance lay in identifying which tools and in what combination and with what kinds of interfacing would be capable of surmounting the obstacles. The combination of techniques that he adopted was very different from the approaches being used by all the major groups struggling to do these simulations in these 15 numerical relativity research groups. The waveform that he found for identical binary black holes, non-spinning, orbiting around each other, colliding and merging, had this very simple form. The early parts of this waveform, the stretch and squeeze as a function of time, are due to just transient waves associated with the way he set his initial conditions. But by this point, the in-spiral waves were the correct prediction and very believable. The merger waves, a very smooth transition to the bring down waves at the end. And this waveform was in good agreement with the Buonanno and Damour effective one body predictions, which surprised me to some degree because it was just amazing how brilliant Buonanno and Damour had been in developing their approximate waveform and pulling it off with such success. The LIGO data analysis was going to require codes that could simulate mass ratios of 1-to-1 up to 10-to-1, vectorial spins on the holes with representative wide range of magnitudes and directions. And this corresponds to 7 non-trivial parameters. And the accuracies needed to be known with confidence. The code had to be fast enough and robust enough to keep up with the LIGO observations. And it was Saul Tucholsky who created and led a large collaboration that constructed the spectral Einstein code, which by 2014 was 10 times faster and 10 times more accurate than any other code. Most importantly, SPEC used pseudo-spectral methods and was based on mathematical formulation that is strongly hyperbolic. These two features guaranteed that SPEC should converge exponentially rapidly as the coordinate grid was refined. Verification of this gave confidence in the code's accuracy, and the exponential convergence made the code 10 times faster and more accurate than any of the other competing codes. The data analysis required generating, however, 100,000 waveforms on the fly for different parameters and comparing with incoming data via matched filtering. From 2006 onward, Buonanno conceived and led an effort toward this. She and her students and postdocs extended the EOB to spinning black holes, as did Damour in parallel. They tuned the EOB by adjusting it to fit hundreds of SXS numerical relativity simulations, thereby creating the combined EOBNR formalism. And they then joined the LIGO scientific collaboration. From 2009 onward, they participated in making EOBNR the foundation for LIGO's EOBNR waveform template family and data analysis pipeline, capable of the 100,000 waveform computations on the fly in a very short periods of time. LIGO's first discovery on 14 September 2015 involved data analysis carried out by combined LIGO-Virgo teams using primarily two data analysis pipelines, EOBNR and one called IMR Phenom, which was conceived and developed largely by Ajith, Hanum, and Husha and colleagues. And they it was a separate pipeline that combined the EOB Inspiral waveforms of Buonanno and Damour, which had been informed by numerical relativity, and combined those Inspiral waveforms with numerical relativity merger and ring down waveforms in a different manner than Buonanno had done. The detection paper showed a comparison of the actual template waveforms in gray that best fit the observations with a SXS numerical relativity waveform, and verified that the numerical relativity waveforms were indeed beautifully reproduced by the templates that had been built by Buonanno and her collaborators. The initial black hole, as one saw from these observations, from the observations comparing the waveforms, had masses of 29 and 36 solar masses for a total of 65 solar masses. The final black hole was 62 solar masses. Three solar masses went into gravitational waves, and the distance to the source was 1.3 billion light years, all deduced by comparing the waveforms with the observations. Buonanno then led the effort to do a series of remarkable tests of general relativity with these observations. She coordinated the data analysis for this, and she co-led the writing of the paper with 1,000 authors. Since then, over the subsequent years, nearly 100 binary black hole mergers with a wide variety of properties and waveforms have been seen. And LIGO and Virgo will turn back on next spring with the improved sensitivity at the level that they should be seeing binary black hole mergers at a rate of about one a day, which is really impressive. I congratulate Alessandra Buonanno, Thibault Damour, Franz Pretorius, and Saul Tucholsky on their very well-deserved Dirac medals. And I thank you.
Thank you very much, Kip, for this wonderful summary of the contributions of the medalists. Okay, Dr. Matsolo, thank you for your presence. I understand you have to leave. Now, we will follow this up by the awarding of the medals. And then there will be lectures by the four medalists, followed by a question and answer session. And then we will also inaugurate, we have now started this new ICTP Dirac medalist exhibit in our staircase, the photo exhibition of Dirac medalists in the Leonardo building. So that will be at the end of this session. So we begin with the awarding of the medals. Yeah, Alessandra, please. So, okay, Saul, we'll try to give it to you remotely.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Congratulations. Okay, now we can move to the talks by the Dirac medalist. I request Professor Buonanno to give her talk here.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm very honored to have just received the Dirac Medal. I also wanted to say that I was here at ICTP 20 years ago, attending as a graduate student in July of that year, the cosmology school. So I'm very delighted to be here again. Okay. Okay, so we start again. Okay, so let's start. So we just heard from Kip Thorne almost seven years ago, the LIGO and Virgo collaboration observed for the first time a gravitational wave from the collision of two black holes. And since then, 85 more binary black holes have been observed by LIGO and Virgo, also two neutron stars, and even mixed binaries formed by neutron star and black holes. And in this plot here, you see the distribution of the black holes detected by LIGO and Virgo in blue. You can appreciate the spread in mass, this is in mass, in solar masses, between 5 and 90 solar masses, the component black holes. And you can see here some of the neutron stars detected by LIGO and Virgo in orange. So Kip Thorne reminded us beautifully the importance of the prediction, the theoretical prediction of the waves, why we are interested in predicting the waves. And one of the reasons is that through the waves, we can learn about the properties of the source that has emitted the waves. So from the frequency evolution, we can infer the masses of the binary. If we know the amplitude, measure the amplitude and the masses, we can infer the distance of the binary with respect to the Earth. From the time of arrivals, the amplitude and the phase of the detector, we can reconstruct the sky location. And if we can observe modulations of the in the amplitude and the phase, we can actually learn whether the binary was moving on a circular orbit or eccentric, whether the black holes were rotating as they were in spiraling around each other. And finally, if we can compare the waveform to deviation from general relativity, we can probe gravity. So this means we need to solve the two-body problem very accurately. And for many years, this problem has been tackled bit in parallel between the analytical relativity effort and the numerical relativity effort until actually 2005 with the breakthrough by Franz Praetorius. And just to say briefly about these analytical techniques. So we heard about post-Newtonian theory, which is applicable. One does an expansion of the Einstein equations in powers of V over C, which is also intertwined with the GM over RC squared, the strength. One can do an expansion of the Einstein equation in post-Minkowskian theory. It's an expansion in G, which is valid for a large separation, but not expanded in velocity. So also important for fast motion. And finally, one can do also an expansion of the Einstein equation in the mass ratio, the gravitational self force. So as Kip was summarizing briefly, I started working in this field when I was a postdoc at IHES. And one of the motivation of our work was, can be summarized in this question, can the two-body dynamics and the radiation of arbitrary mass ratio binary black holes be deduced with simple mapping from the results of test body limit or the so-called probe limit? And following this motivation, we wrote with Thibault Damour the first paper where we mapped the two-body dynamics in the dynamics of an effective body, which move in a deformed space-time, at the time the Schwarzschild space-time, because we were considering non-spinning objects. And this mapping, which was also inspired by results in quantum field theory, led to a resummation of the Hamiltonian and also the binding energy, the post-Newtonian results through this simple formula here. In 1999, I moved to Caltech in actually the group of Kip Thorne. And at the time, we completed actually the second paper where we provided also the dynamics and of the inspiral up to the plunge. The waveform, which the full waveform, including also the merger ring down, which was actually estimated semi-analytically with some based on results not at the time. I want to emphasize, for example, just within the model, we could estimate the final mass and final spin of the black hole and deduce the quasi-normal modes that then could be actually matched simply with the imposing continuation of the waveform, analytic continuation between the in-spiral plunge and the merger in down. So since then, a lot of work has been done, especially since the breakthrough of Franz Praetorius in 2005, to improve the theory part of the EOB, but also to complete through numerical relativity simulations. And so I want a moment to spend a slide just to emphasize the main steps. So originally, if you compare the waveform without any information from numerical relativity, you will have some differences after a certain number of cycles, as you can see in this upper panel. But then you include higher order corrections in, for example, unknown post-Newtonian terms, and you can fit them from numerical relativity and improve the agreement. And this is done for one waveform, but then basically you repeat this for many numerical relativity waveforms here represented in the space of the combination of the spins in the binary and the symmetric mass ratio. And this is an example of a calibration that we did to prepare for the LIGO-Virgo first run and then improvement for the subsequent runs. So you basically calibrate the model in this point of the parameter space where you have very accurate numerical relativity simulation that were taken from the SXX catalog. And notice also at very low mass ratio, we also use actually equation for the waveform for the in-spiral merger in down obtained by solving the so-called Tsiolkovsky equation. And did this work, the so-called S for spin UBNR waveforms. And this is actually the template bank that was used in the LIGO runs. You can see at low masses, plain post-Newtonian templates were used for binary neutron stars, but for masses above three solar masses, waveform for neutron star black hole and binary black hole, you needed to include also the merger in down. Now, this is not the only family that is used for LIGO and Virgo inference analysis. Kip Thorne was actually referring to the in-spiral merger in down phenomenological waveform, mainly developed by Ajit and Mark Hanam and Sasha Husa. There is another also version of the EOB waveform models that has been mainly developed by Alessandro Naga, Thibault Damour, and Sebastiano Bernuzzi, and more recently, also numerical relativity waveform obtained interpolating directly, interpolating directly numerical relativity waveform have been also developed, the so-called NR surrogate waveforms. Okay, so now just to explain why these waveforms are important, to what we learn by using them and not something, you know, less accurate. So I want to make two examples. The first one, the 14 of August 2019, the LIGO and Virgo collaboration observed a binary with a puzzling companion. The primary black hole, the primary object is certainly a black hole because it has a mass 23 times the mass of the sun, but a smaller object, we don't know whether it's a black hole or a neutron star because a neutron star maximum mass for standard equation of state is around 2.1, 2.2, and in this case was around 2.6 solar masses. So it was very important actually to nail down that value. And I want also to emphasize that because of the very large mass ratio in the binary, this event, which here is represented through this visualization, was also very rich in the emission of gravitational waves. Higher harmonics could be also observed. So you see here the different actually harmonics pull out here. This appears 9 seconds before merger, and then 4 seconds before merger, you start seeing maybe not very well from the plot, from the screen, the L equal 4, M equal 4, and then the L equal 5, M equal 5, very close to merger, around 1 second. Now, to explain the importance of the waveform models. So this is the posterior distribution of the secondary mass, and you can see the two different waveform models, EOBNR and Phenom. And only when you include the higher harmonics, when you include the precession P, you can have a much tighter posterior distribution and compute the mass, measure the mass of the secondary with larger accuracy. The other example I wanted to make is the largest binary black hole observed by LIGO and Virgo, the 21st of May 2019. This is also a numerical relativity simulation that was produced for the event. And the particularity of this is also that the mass, especially of the primary, lies in a region where we should not expect black holes because of the pair instability supernova. And in fact, one possibility, but it's not the only one, there have been also, quite a few papers in the literature, is that this black hole is a second generation black hole, maybe formed by another, the merger of two black holes. Now, I wanted also to refer to the application of the waveform model for example, test of general relativity. And here I want to refer to two examples. So the first one, from the in-spiral part of the signal, the phase can be expanded in post-Newtonian terms, and this coefficient depends on physical effects. We can allow this coefficient to be different from the value predicted by general relativity, and so we can look at whether we see deviation. We don't see any deviation, actually, on this parameter, but we can use the result to put a bound on the post-Newtonian parameters that are in this plot here, and I want to focus on the minus 1 PM parameter, which is described a dipole emission, would not be there in general relativity, will be there in some scalar tensor theory. And just to emphasize, with the first neutron star black hole, we have put a bound at the level of 10 to the minus 3, with the first binary neutron star, a bound around 10 to the minus 5. For the higher post-Newtonian parameter, we have to rely on binary black holes in spirals. And you see here the bound for different, actually, events, and then the combined bound. Some of these parameters today are at the level of 10%. The second example I wanted to make is to understand the properties of the remnant that forms after two black holes, two compact object, dark compact object merge. And here, in general relativity, we expect that the remnant black hole relaxes to the solution of Kerr and emits quasi-normal modes. And this was possible, actually, to observe, at least measure the dominant ones. The signal-to-noise ratio that we have in the merge ring-down is not very high to actually measure higher harmonics for the ring-down. And just an example, the deviation in the frequency and decay time of the quasi-normal mode of the dominant mode, you see here the posterior distribution that encompasses zero, which means GR is still not violated. Okay, so now I want to talk a moment about the next few years. So first of all, binaries systems are everywhere. The results of Gaia have told us that there are 1.3 million of binary systems at 1 kiloparsec around the, from the Earth, okay? Now, not all these binary systems form, end up in black hole binaries or neutron star binaries, but certainly a large portion. And one of the important questions that astrophysicists are interested in is understand what are the formation scenarios of the binaries that we are seeing with LIGO and Virgo. And in order to extract this information, it's important, for example, to measure properties like eccentricity or the spin magnitude or the spin precession. And also, if we can extract the signatures of the astrophysical environment of the system, knowing whether the binary was actually a triple system, there was a third body, or it was in a disk or gas, we can also unveil the formation scenario. Now, let me say that the binary that we observe with LIGO and Virgo in this spectrum of the mass of the black holes is actually in this region here, the stellar mass black hole, or even in the pair instability gap. But there are actually black holes with much larger mass in our universe. Think about the black hole at the center of our galaxy. This is actually the largest black hole known today. And so also these black holes we want to measure with gravitational waves. And the black holes at the center, at the core of the galaxy, are very important. They play a very important role. They have a symbiotic relationship with the galaxy, and they ultimately influence also the growth of structures in our universe. Black holes, I remind you, grow their mass to accretion and merger. And you see here actually a typical merger tree. Two galaxies form, merge and form a new black hole and so forth. So on. Okay. So we are going actually to open a new frequency band in the next decade and have the possibility to observe these other classes of black holes. So we expect new facilities on the ground, the Cosmic Explorer in the US and the Einstein Telescope in Europe. They will improve the sensitivity with respect to LIGO and Virgo by one or two order of magnitude, actually improving especially at low frequency, which will allow to bring in band black holes with even larger masses, several hundreds and thousands of solar masses. And these black holes could be seen up to a distance of 10 in redshift or 20, when the universe was 10 or 20 times smaller. Now, I want a moment to impress you about the kind of system, how many we are going to see, and the signal to noise ratio. There will be a few tens of binary black holes that can be seen for 10 minutes with signal to noise ratio larger than 1,000, and 20,000 binary black holes with signal to noise ratio larger than 100. Binary neutron star can also be observed, and this will be very important with very large signal to noise ratio to nail down the equation of state of neutron stars. The signal will be much more complicated. We will observe intermediate mass ratio in spirals. This is the dynamics, the orbits at 1 Hz and then at 10 Hz. So much more complicated. In the next decade, we will see also the first interferometer in space, LISA, supposed to be launched in 2035, which will open the frequency band around the millihertz and allow to see new sources, extreme mass ratio in spirals that you see here, supermassive black holes at the center of galaxy merging with very large signal to noise ratio, white dwarf binaries in our galaxy. And with much larger signal to noise ratio, we will perhaps see have the possibility to observe or discover new fundamental particles like ultralight boson forming boson clouds around the black holes and rotating and emitting gravitational waves. And with this large signal to noise ratio, we might probe more the horizon, understanding whether it's really an absorbing surface and not has no reflectivity. Okay, so now in order to take advantage of these detectors in the next decade, and even in the next actually few years, we need actually to continue to improve the waveform models and merge together use together all the different approximation that I was describing before. And in fact, we will need maybe two or more order of magnitude of improvement in accuracy depending on the parameter space. And now we can do this by extending post-Newtonian calculations. Today, they are known in the conservative part at 4 p.m., but even the dissipative part is almost completed now at 4 p.m. We can do also calculation in post-Minkowskian theory. The expectation is that perhaps for really the next decade, we will need up to 6 p.m. or 7 post-Minkowskian order. And for that, to gain accuracy, will be important to combine this different approximation within the effective one-body framework, perhaps in novel ways to gain more effectively. We also would need a numerical relativity simulation with larger accuracy and also extend them in the region more extreme in the parameters, the large mass ratio, spins, and eccentricity. Perhaps Soltiokoski will touch on this topic. And perhaps we think also we need to rethink the strategy of the two-body problem in GR and beyond, and unify the description of bound and unbound orbits. And I think also Thibault will touch on this in his presentation. So the first SU binar model was actually developed in 2007. 2009 was used for the first template bank in Language Virgo. Today we have the fifth generation. I want to show you just as an example, the improvement with respect to the previous generation that was used in the last LIGO run. This is in preparation of the new run. This is the so-called unfaithfulness, the match with numerical relativity waveform, many of them after the calibration. Unfaithfulness zero here means basically that the two match perfectly. So you see here 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3. There are gaps in numerical relativity waveform, although we have a much larger covering today with the SXX 442 line spin waveforms. And another interesting thing, today we could also add uncertainty on the waveform models, basically the uncertainty that comes from the calibration to numerical relativity will be important when we do parameter estimation. Now, the other example I wanted to make include eccentricity. Many people are working on it in preparation of the new run. This is an example of a reanalysis of the second event of the LIGO and Virgo collaboration with a waveform with eccentricity and spin effects. And you can see a mild, the Poisson distribution peaking around the very small value of the eccentricity. Eccentric waveforms also allow to go in the limit of dynamical capture. So these are events that maybe are less likely to be seen with LIGO and Virgo, but nevertheless, it's good to have waveform models. And I want to emphasize there are many groups that are working on that, and not just us. One comment I wanted to make, if you put together the different approximation methods, this is just the periastron distance, sorry, as a function of the eccentricity. There is actually an advantage of post-Minkowskian with respect to post-Newtonian when you add eccentricity. And so it will be important, for example, to push this post-Minkowskian calculation at higher order, as people are already doing today. So they are also quite important. So I have just to plot to show, in fact, the improvement also post-Minkowskian calculation. This is the scattering angle that can be computed in numerical relativity. And these are the different approximations in the post-Minkowskian today known at 4 p.m. And for the bound case, one can compare this calculation to the binding energy, again, computed in numerical relativity. And this is the improvement at different post-Minkowskian orders. And I should say, this is not the end of the story. There are some subtleties in using the 4 post-Minkowskian for computing binding energy. So for the bound case, and I'm sure also that Thibault Damour will talk more about this. I cannot finish my talk without actually mentioning another important results in analytical calculation from the gravitational self-force. The second order gravitational self-force has been now computed for quasi-circular orbits and non-spinning. And the amazing thing is that although this approximation, which is an expansion in the mass ratio, should be valid for very large mass ratio, when you compare to a numerical relativity simulation of mass ratio 10, the second order self-force agrees very well with numerical relativity, even just a few cycles before merger. So let me conclude now. The gravitational wave spectrum has been open with LIGO and Virgo, and soon also LIGO India, and actually Kagra also already joined the collaboration. Lisa and will be there in the next decade. I talked about Einstein Telescope and Cosmic Explorer. There are also these other experiments here. And I want, since there are young people here in the audience, actually looking more into the future, there is the possibility going into 2050. So just thinking about the mission after LISA, in the next few years, there will be a selection as part of the ESA Voyage 2050 team between gravitational wave and cosmic microwave background radiation that could bring a new detector in space, either in the deci-Hertz or in the micro-Hertz. So I want to conclude by thanking all the people with whom I worked actually in the last 15 years, starting from the postdoc and graduate student at the University of Maryland, and then also at AI, and also many collaborators. My group also, the AI, And of course, the LIGO and Virgo and CAGRA collaboration and all the agency that have funded it. And so thank you for this, for your attention.
Okay, I invite Professor Damour to give the next talk.
It is a great honor and a especially great pleasure to be awarded the Dirac Medal here at ICTP, because actually I met Dirac here in probably in this building in July 1979. It was difficult to find a photograph of this. Was during the second Marcel Grossman meeting organized by Abdus Salam and Remo Ruffini. And the only picture I could find was, it does not really work, the thing, this thing. Yes, now it works. Dirac listening to Young. Okay, so you can see Dirac just on the side. But a few days later, Dirac attended the Lindau meeting in the same month of July. So here you see Dirac from his face. And actually, I was lucky and bold enough to come and ask a question to Dirac, and he even answered. So I was one of the lucky people to hear a few words from Dirac, who was, you know, usually not answering or just yes, no. Anyway, I want to motivate going in the same direction as part of the talk of Alessandra, give some glimpses of the new methods and why the new theoretical methods linked to scattering are interesting. So just to repeat points already made. So Alessandra beautifully explained and Kip explained that there are several parts of the waveform from the in-spiral, late in-spiral, where the resummation using effective one-body allows to push up to merger, but the full confirmed knowledge of merger came after the numerical breakthrough and then the ring down of the black hole. Resummation is used at several levels in EUB, both in the conservative dynamics described by an Hamiltonian and in the radiation reaction force. So what are we talking about? We are talking about here it is a space-time diagram where time goes up and space is horizontal of two black holes, here represented by the horizons, the surface of the two black holes, moving around each other for hundreds of millions of years, emitting gravitational radiation with a back effect of gravitational reaction on the motion, which makes them get closer, go faster, and ultimately merge. So the mathematical problem is we should solve Einstein equations, which are explicitly written here. From the methods which have been employed up to now in the actual data analysis of LIGO-Virgo was a combination of methods developed over many years, already mentioned, post-Newtonian, post-Minkowskian, multipolar post-Minkowskian, developed in particular with Luc Blanchet and Bala Ayer, but also other methods with an important complementarity with numerical relativity. And I want to emphasize that new methods have been developed over the last years and are being developed. The tutti-frutti method developed with Donato Bini and Andrea Geralico, Donato is here. But I want to talk about scattering how, although we are talking about the bound state problem, how concepts and methods coming often from quantum field theory about scattering problem can be useful. Now, this new angle of attack on the two-body dynamics, meaning let's using the scattering where you have two bodies which come from infinity, which cross at a distance at some impact parameter and then come out at a different angle. The idea that it could be a useful complement to things was emphasized in this paper. And in particular, in this paper, I urged, first I mentioned that the work of Amati Chafaloni Veneziano that I'm going to discuss more. And I was urging amplitude experts to use their novel techniques to compute the two-loop scattering amplitudes of scalar masses at the third post-mean Kosken approximation. This idea was then pushed forward by Chung, Rothstein, and so on. Now, actually, the idea to use quantum scattering amplitude to extract essentially the interaction potential, the gravitational interaction potential between two bodies, had been first developed by Corinne Aldesi, I mean, proposed by Corinne Aldesi in the 50s. And the Japan, I mean, Iwasaki was the first one to reach in 71 by using Feynman diagrams, the result that had been obtained by Lorentz and Drossi in 1917. So you see, it did not appear from outside as being a super efficient way of doing post-Newtonian computation. But a breakthrough was obtained by Daniele Amati here, who was here in at CISA, so in this building, no? He is here, Daniele, ah, ciao. And Marcello Ciafaloni and Gabriele Veneziano in a long-term project whose idea was to understand at the quantum level what happens in ultra-energy collision of particles to see when you create black holes and to understand the unitarity question of forming black holes. But a side product of the result was using sophisticated Rege-Grybov techniques was to compute at the two-loop level the scattering angle as of two massless particles or two ultra-energy particles, the Econal phase being essentially the exponent of the scattering amplitude or the radial action essentially. And then, so this was work done in around 1990. After this, new techniques actually coming from string theory, the fact that string theory is telling us that gravity is like the square of Young-Mills or Maxwell, is which has been generalized within QFT by Zwiebern, Carrasco, Johansson, and many people. The idea is one can use all those techniques to go beyond what can be done by other methods. Let me also quickly mention that here we are talking about using quantum scattering effect of two particles. So you have two quantum particles described by states in a Hilbert space that scatter, but you are interested actually in the classical limit of this. And one can also do the computation purely at the classical level, except that in the old days when we did that in the 1980s, we were blocked by the computation of integrals, and beyond one loop, we did not know how to compute integrals, so we stopped. But recently, inherited from quantum field theories, beautiful integration techniques has allowed, in particular the group of Rafael Porto, to reproduce the results of others that I will describe now. Just a few words about the effective one-body approach. So it was, as Alessandra already motivated, it was historically motivated by work by Brezin, Edouard Brezin, Claude Itzigson, and Jean Zinn-Justin, which was a quantum scattering resummation of Econal resummation in QED. But that they said that one can, instead of having a two-body problem, maybe one can have an effective Coulomb problem to describe this. So this idea was transcribed within gravity. And the idea is, instead of describing a two-body system for bound states as being two particles going around and having an Hamiltonian of interaction, you replace that by some particle of mass mu, the effective mass mu, like Newton, moving in some effective space-time metric with Finsler corrections, and the idea, which is looks like a much simpler condition, but you have to find what is the effective metric and what are these corrections, which are equivalent to this more complicated things. So originally, the effective one-body approach was done for bound state. But then the idea in 2016-18 was to say, but the same idea can be done directly if you don't have bound state observables, like the radial action and the Bohr-Sommerfeld Delaunay Hamiltonian, but you have scattering data. So if you know the real scattering angle, classical scattering angle of two particles coming with some energy and angular momentum, and you know the scattering angle as a function of energy and angular momentum, actually you can identify this to the deflection angle of an effective particle of mass mu moving, satisfying some generalized mass shell condition of this type. And I have shown then that if you have the information, say, in expanded manner for the scattering angle, you can use this information by simple formulas and interpret this in terms of an effective energy-dependent potential. Like this term is a potential in 1 over r squared plus 1 over r cubed, et cetera, with function of energy. And all this can be is in one-to-one correspondence with the other thing. And then I applied this to the result of Amati, Ciafaloni, Veneziano, who had computed at the two-loop level, third order in G, what was the scattering angle of two massless particles, very energetic massless particles coming in and scattering because of their gravitational interaction. They had found a result which had a nice expansion of this type. And then I could say, okay, this result is equivalent to some Hamiltonian in EUB description. Everything looked nice, okay? But then prompted by what I had said, because I had urged and I discussed personally with Zvi Bern saying, okay, please, I know that you can do it, so please do it. And they did it. The group of Zvi Bern with many people here, it was a big effort. They succeeded in getting at third order in Newton's interaction using directly precisely not Feynman diagrams, but their double copy, et cetera, and integration techniques. They computed this. And then they could compute at the same level of approximation as Amati, Ciafaloni, Veneziano, what is the scattering angle, but now for particles of finite mass, not massless particle, but finite mass. And the big surprise was that if you take their answer, and then you take the limit where the masses go to zero, fixing the energy, so they go faster and faster, you know, at smaller, and so it should reproduce the result of Amati, Ciafaloni, Veneziano, but it did not because there was a logarithmic term coming from an arcsinh, which is somewhere here, yes, from this arcsinh. And then actually there was no high energy limit of the result of Zvi Bern, so it created some doubts and confusion. At some point we said, maybe there is something not fully correct, in which case Zvi Bern said, okay, let's immediately bet a bottle of wine. We still have to drink it because of the pandemic, and we will share it. Because actually, thanks to extra work with Donato and also work by Bruin, we could check that Zvi Bern was correct. Therefore, there was no doubt that their formula was correct, but still there was a big puzzle. And this puzzle, it took actually 3 years to understand why there was a discrepancy between the finite mass calculation at two loops of Zvi Bern and the Amati Ciafaloni massless scattering result. The result was that hidden in the computation of the group of Zvi Bern was an assumption that one was not computing the full physical scattering angle, including the back action of radiation, the fact that this system emits a lot of gravitons, and therefore this should have an effect on the scattering. But this was essentially what in classical physics you would call the Fokker-Wheeler-Feynman time symmetric interaction with a time symmetric Green's function. And using a result derived with Donato Bini, and which was preceded actually by some old work with Nathalie Deruel about radiative corrections linked to angular momentum loss. So the fact that in the collision, you emit gravitons, and these gravitons take away part of the angular momentum of the system and also energy, but what is crucial here is angular momentum, is crucial. And this was understood from two different ways. One was a quantum calculation due to Paolo di Vecchia, Carlo Heisenberg, Rodolfo Russo, and Gabriele Veneziano, where they could relate what was implicit in the calculation of Amati, Ciafferoni, Veneziano, I mean, an explicit, that actually there was a link between the real part and the imaginary part of the Econol angle, which means between losses of unitarity, not of unitarity, but of the two sector linked to radiation effects at the quantum level. And they could relate this in this paper of Paolo di Vecchia to the soft radiation emitted spectrum and the Weinberg famous soft graviton thing. And independently, I could show by a very simple calculation, taking only one line, that using the formula with Donato, this can be obtained from the angular momentum loss, okay? But so now we have at the cubic order in G, there is a complete understanding of the scattering, but there is more than this. Using quantum field theory techniques, to very beautiful techniques to compute complicated integrals, those authors were able to compute at cubic order something which had been written down by Kovacs and Kip Thorne many years ago in the form of some integrals that nobody could compute. And still today, nobody can compute these integrals in the time domain, but they were computed recently by going to Fourier space with this nice formula. One could also have the radiated, so it's both the momentum transfer, the delta P mu of each particle, and the radiated momentum. And recent work by other authors have fully confirms these results. But now the frontier is at the next level, okay, using quantum scattering amplitudes at free loop, which means fourth order in the Newtonian interaction. So you see it's described by diagrams here where you have three loops, as you can see here. And if you count the number of square root of G at each point in this diagram, you will find that this is a G4. Now, at this G4 level, again, the group at Zwiebeln was able to compute part of it, which is using only the gravitons, which have momenta comparable to the distance to the impact parameter, so so-called potential gravitons. And still, you see how this quantum field theory technology allows to get very complicated. I mean, I know that by standards of Pier Paolo Mastroglia and others, this is not so sophisticated, but still LE2, and then, but then you have elliptic integrals, complete elliptic integral E and K, okay? So this is a certain level of sophistication. But then this answer is incomplete. And with Donato, using our tutti-frutti method that I did not describe, we could compute at the 6 PN level what is the post-Newtonian expanded contribution to G4 coming from radiating effects. Because what happens is when you have two world lines that interact by gravitons, most of the scattering is due to gravitons which have momenta comparable to the inverse impact parameter, okay? But part of the answer comes from gravitons which are nearly radiated away, okay? Very soft, I mean, soft gravitons, which are called radiation type gravitons that you need to include. And this is linked to a classical effect that was first understood by Luc Blanchet and myself in 1988, that in the interaction between the two bodies, there are part of the interaction which is non-local in time, because it is due to the fact that the gravitational waves was emitted very long ago by the system, backscattered on the curvature of space-time, and then focused back on the system, creating correlations over a very long time. So we could compute this in a PN expanded way. And this helped Zwiebeln and his group to check their full, so they did compute the full answer, including now these things, okay? But still there are puzzles, okay? We know that this thing does not include real back reaction effects of radiation, okay? It is the part, it has included part of the radiative effects which are time symmetric in a sense, which is surprising that radiative effects can also be time symmetric, but it is. And the part which is time dissymmetric and the square of the time dissymmetric effects enter actually at the G4, G5 and G6 level. And as of today, there exist still puzzles and discrepancies between computations which are QFT based in EFT language due to Johannes Blumlein and his group and Fofas Tourani, where they computed some numbers. And we have shown that these numbers should satisfy this constraint, but they do not satisfy this constraint. So it's an interesting situation where we have a beautiful tool, which definitely will be an important part of progress in the future, but they are conceptual puzzles and physicists love to have conceptual puzzles. Those conceptual puzzles are linked to the basic idea that when you have Green's function, which means propagation of gravitons between two world lines, you have different Green's function depending at the classical level. You could say, okay, if I am really talking about a physical effect, I should use the retarded Green's function. But if I want an effective action, I should use the Fokker time symmetric Green's function. If I'm doing a quantum calculation and I use the usual in-out formalism, I have a Feynman Green's function, which is actually linked to this plus radiative effects. And then you have other things, how to take into account radiation reaction effects. And today we don't know yet how to do it. So I just want to conclude by saying that as Alessandra also emphasized, analytical approaches to gravitational wave signals played a crucial role in the past, but is needed for future improvements. Now, over the last years, many ideas of the community coming from many things, from early days of quantum field theory, early days of string theory, all those tools now combine together and allows to compute effects beyond what can be computed by other methods, but with puzzles. And the final word is what Henri Poincaré said about deep problem in physics, you know, that there are no important problems in physics which are definitely solved problems, but they are always more or less solved. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Thibault. And now I request Professor Pretorius to give his talk.
Thank you very much. I want to echo Alessandra and Thibault in my sort of my honor and receiving this award. You know, it's a great honor. And also I want to just thank a lot of the people that, you know, some of them have been named as collaborators, some haven't been named, but in the community as a whole, it collaborated and contributed to the sort of the background of knowledge that we sort of built on to get to the this place. So again, thank you. It's a great honor. So what I'm going to talk about today are some open questions on the dynamics of black holes. So what I'll give is a very brief reminder of what we do know about the theory of black holes. And then, you know, I guess most of this, the talks and this prize has been on things that we do know about, which I guess makes sense, you know, you award things to discoveries and not the unknown. But I want to sort of ask the question, you know, given everything that we've learned about the dynamics of black holes, are there some open questions or open problems? And there are a couple of regimes that, where I will say that there are, I think, in my opinion, some interesting, perhaps only of theoretical interest, but some interesting open problems. And this relates to the perturbations, the nonlinear perturbations of near extremal Kerr black holes and the ultra relativistic limit of the binary black hole interactions. So very similar sort of in spirit to what Thibault spoke about. And I'm going to be focusing on the small impact parameter case. Okay, so what do we know about black holes? In very brief, I think our modern understanding of black holes came quite late in the understanding of Einstein's theory. I'd say, what we think of black holes today, at least how we understand them today, was the knowledge largely came from what Kip Thorne called the golden age of general relativity in the 60s and 70s. Of course, there are many highlights I could have picked from, but I just mentioned a few of the key ones. So for instance, the genericity of singularities inside of black holes, Penrose's famous singularity theorems, the uniqueness or no-hair properties of isolated stationary black holes that was pioneered by Israel and then completed by other authors. Of course, the astonishing result that for complicated equations as Einstein equations, we have an exact analytical solution that we think describes essentially every isolated black hole in the universe, the Kerr solution, which was very much ties in with the uniqueness properties of black holes. And then another fascinating properties of black holes that was uncovered then is sort of their thermal properties. First sort of noticed in analogy with the laws of thermodynamics and the laws of black hole mechanics, and then in some sense put in a more real footing by Hawking's discovery of Hawking radiation. Of course, that would have been very interesting, just from a theoretical perspective, but what really made it so black holes so relevant and why we're still studying black holes in the dynamics today is kind of at the same time people realize that there actually are black holes in the universe. From the first stellar mass black hole candidate, Cygnus X1, that was discovered around that time, and quasars, which were discovered a bit earlier, but that's essentially the first, or then it was realized in this time frame that you could understand the energetics of quasars by appealing to a supermassive black hole as being the central engine. So since then, we've understood, we've learned a lot about the dynamics of binary black holes, which is essentially what this award is celebrating this year. I mean, of course, that ushered in this new era of gravitational wave observation of the universe that Kip spoke so eloquently about, and Alessandra and Thibault. So essentially, from the golden age till, in the last 20, 30 years, we've now also got a very good understanding of the dynamics of pairs of black holes, binary black holes. So again, that brings me to the main topic of this question. Well, what don't we know about the dynamics of black holes today? And let me just immediately say, I'm restricting this question quite significantly. So I'm thinking just asymptotically flat four-dimensional space times. And my bar for what no is pretty low. It's the physicist's bar of just about understanding sort of the qualitative answers of what's going on. Of course, if I set the bar at say the theoretical gold standard of a mathematical proof, then we don't really know, we know very little about black holes. Mathematical relativists are, I think, quite close to proving the nonlinear stability of the Kerr solution, but that today is still an open problem at that level of rigor. So I'm not nearly thinking of that level of rigor. So just with these restrictions, what don't we know about black holes in classical relativity today? And again, I mentioned these first two nonlinear perturbations of near extremal Kerr or extremal, the generic outcome of ultra-relativistic limit of black hole interactions. And then another top area that we also know very little about is the interior of a generic black hole formed from gravitational collapse. And unfortunately, I won't have time to say anything about that, but that's also a very interesting, there are a lot of interesting open questions there. Let me now describe these two cases, and the rest of the talk is mostly going to be just motivating this, that there are some interesting questions and then just some wild speculations. So anyone can criticize these as much as you want, that's completely fine. They're just perhaps wild speculations. Okay, so what is the motivation, if you will, for studying near extremal Kerr black holes? Well, one is pure theoretical interest. There's an off chance that these might be relevant to gravitational wave observations if supermassive black holes, or if there are some supermassive black holes that spin near to maximal. And unfortunately, what I mean by near extremal, as you'll see later with some examples, is we need many nines. So perhaps like 1 or 2.9, 0.99 is not going to be good enough. We perhaps need 4 or 5 nines. So does nature spin up some supermassive black holes to such a high level? If they do, then extreme mass ratio in spirals where the back reaction is relatively small and it won't sort of kick it away from extremality, unlike comparable mass mergers, that could be a test bed to observe some of these quantities. But you know, who knows if nature provides that. Okay, so why might there be something interesting in the nonlinear perturbation? So we know what happens at the linear level. That's thanks to Tucholsky, the Tucholsky equation and work by Tucholsky and Press. And there's sort of two interesting things that happen with linear perturbations of extremal curve that suggest something interesting might happen at the nonlinear level. The first is that the damping time of the dominant quasi-normal mode, or you know, family of quasi-normal modes, that goes to zero in the extremal limit. So these waves, if you perturb a near extremal black hole, the perturbation can sit around for a long time. Another interesting property about perturbations of rotating black holes, and these are in any rotation, it doesn't have to be extremal or near extremal, but they have this super radiance phenomenon. So if you excite a black hole with a low frequency gravitational wave at a certain level, you can extract rotational energy from black holes. But then the interesting thing is the onset of super radiance. So sort of in a sense, when the black hole at the linear level is acting like a perfect reflector, the onset of that frequency becomes equal to the onset of super radiance in the extremal limit. So you've got these two frequencies that become commensurate in the extremal limit. So what that suggests is that conditions are actually favorable for some form of strong turbulent dynamics to occur on the horizon of near extremal black holes. So what is turbulence, strong turbulence? I don't really have very good answers. A lot of people don't, but at least there's one definition that I think perhaps makes sense here. And one is, if you look at a nonlinear ringing system, by definition, it has weak turbulence. Weak turbulence is just mode coupling. So beyond linear order, modes are going to talk to each other. There's going to be an exchange of energy. It becomes strong if on some relevant local dynamical timescale, there can be a strong exchange of energy between the modes. So in hydrodynamics, sometimes this is termed in terms of like the eddy turnover time scale. You can have strong turbulence if on an eddy time, significant energy can be transferred to smaller or larger eddies, depending on whether the turbulent cascade is direct or indirect. Now with curved black holes, we know that at least for most of the times, perhaps all, but at least for sub-extremal black holes, we don't have strong turbulence, because the system loses energy because it's not a normal mode, they're quasi-normal mode, so it loses energy and the rate of decay is just too rapid for there to be much interaction. So that's one reason, well let's get rid of the decay, and we can do that by going to the extreme limit. So that's sort of that one point. But then also you think, well, okay, now you're perturbing a black hole, there's gonna be back reaction. If we have to be very close to extremality, that the perturbation of a ring down mode in general, you'd think would push it away from extremality if cosmic sensors should be satisfied. And that is a big if, but let's assume that it is satisfied. But you also want to try to limit the effects of back reaction. And so this onset of super radiance, at least in terms of the parameters of black holes at leading order, might be a good place to actually have less back reaction. So these modes can sit around and actually interact in a non-trivial fashion. Let me just give you a bit of sort of one unrelated and then one perhaps related bit of evidence that there might be interesting things going on. And so this bit of evidence actually now appeals to outside of this class that I've spoken about. It's not asymptotically flat space, but asymptotically anti-de Sitter space. And this comes from the gauge gravity dualities of string theory, which actually in certain situations, in particular asymptotically anti-de Sitter space, makes very precise the dictionary between black hole dynamics and hydrodynamics. And I think inspired by this, people then thought, well, we know that fluids exhibit strong turbulence. So black brains in anti-de Sitter space people look for it and they found that both from the gravitational wave perspective and on the holographic dual in the fluid perspective. So this is work by Adams, Chesler, and Liu that looks at perturbations of a black brain in asymptotically anti-de Sitter space And clearly you can see, you know, that's a very interesting turbulent dynamics that's unfolding there. Now this is actually is decaying, and they factor out the overall decay, but these modes are interacting in a very interesting fashion. So now going back to the Kerr case, these authors have sort of speculated about, well, is that possible in Kerr in asymptotically flat? And they try to come up with an effective Reynolds number to which might be an indication of when it might happen. And they sort of argue that yes, it should, but you need, I think, at least the four nines or higher to get to this. So 0.9999 at least. Now just one other interesting thing, this is from work that I did with Will East and Fethi Ramazana group. And this was, we were just looking at super radiant scattering. And so here we had a black hole of 0.99. So this is kind of low in this thing, but that's very challenging numerically to go to high spin. So this is a pretty low spin. We were wanting to study the nonlinear effects in super radiant. So we took these clouds of gravitational energy with about 10% of the mass of the space time. So we wanted it to be quite nonlinear. And this animation is just going to show an example. So the blue is going to be the imploding gravitational wave as measured by this Neeman-Penrose scalar psi zero. And then the red is going to be the scattered wave. And this is just sort of to illustrate. And that little Mentos thing there, that's the apparent horizon. It's spinning. And as you see, as the gravitational waves interact, it actually started to notice the spin. And that's because now it's axisymmetric, so you don't see the spin, but that the gravitational wave deforms the horizon. So here comes the imploding wave, interacts with the black hole, it starts to perturb the black hole, and now we get this wave that's propagating outward. I mean, you can't see that it's super radiant from this animation, but this is sort of the example we looked at. Okay, so what was interesting about the study was actually not the super radiance or the sub radiance, but the thing that happened when we sort of tuned the frequency of the waves to the quasi-normal mode frequency of this black hole. So here are properties of the dynamical horizon of the black hole as a function of time. And incidentally, this this sort of jaggedy behavior over there, that's just where when it was really dynamical, the apparent horizon, the finder had trouble finding the apparent horizon. So that's a failure of the apparent horizon finder. So the irreducible mass here in this middle panel, that does increase even for dynamical horizons. It's not an artifact of coordinates. So that's just a messy code thing. But then, okay, what this is supposed to show is, okay, the super radiant case, the black curve, and you can see the mass of the black hole does decrease after the interaction, as does the spin, but the area increases as is consistent. A sub radiant case here, where it absorbs essentially the 10% of the energy. But then the interesting thing is the quasi-normal mode case, where you could, at least from this parameter, this picture, it doesn't look like the least amount of change is happening to the black hole. And incidentally, this kind of quantitatively says how far away we are from extremality. So again, at extremality, these two frequencies, the black and the red, should be, so they go to one, but you see they're quite different, not just 1% like you'd think from being in a spin of 0.99. But now if we look at the properties of the horizon, so like that little deformed white sphere that you saw, here's what I'm meaning, why this is the interesting frequency, this quasi-normal mode frequency. So in terms of two measures, sort of a ratio of the proper to equatorial circumference of the horizon. And yeah, this is the intrinsic curvature of the horizon. And again, these straight lines, this would be for extremal black holes. So again, you can see why the difference between the lines and thinking how far from extremal we are to begin with, even at 0.99. But we can see that the largest perturbation of this horizon is occurring at this quasi-normal mode frequency. So again, extrapolating to the case of extremal, what that might suggest is that, you know, in some sense, okay, so you can see even at 0.99, they did decay fast. The waves are going to sit there for a long time. But, you know, probably Kerr black holes satisfy cosmic censorship. But I'm guessing if there's a way to violate cosmic censorship, to overspin a black hole, that's going to be in this limit. So if we implode a wave onto the black hole, we fine tune it to this quasi-normal mode, and we take the limit to extremality, it might be a set of measure zero, but I think that's where we could see some fireworks and perhaps break a black hole, and where we might get some turbulent dynamics. Again, just crazy speculation, I don't know. But that's why we don't know this about. This is an aspect of black hole dynamics we don't know anything about. Okay, now let me just briefly mention about the scattering problem. So again, the motivation here, mostly theoretical interest. What got me interested in this, a while ago, was the possibility that, in the LHC, that it could produce black holes. And the ideas were these, inspired by large extra dimension scenarios that suggested that our usual sort of definition of the Planck scale is actually not correct. If there are large extra dimensions, there could be a much lower true Planck scale. And if you collide fundamental particles sufficiently above this scale, then it's essentially, again, a purely classical interaction and you should form black holes. Now, unfortunately, LHC didn't find black holes. That would have been astonishing. And that's essentially telling us that the Planck scale, even if there are all these kind of bizarre scenarios, can't be at a TeV, it might be higher, but the naturalness arguments that argued for a TeV are now not so natural if it's 10 or higher. But in any case, that is one interesting possible observational motivation. And here again, I'm thinking here about the very small impact parameter case. So perhaps these calculations will also be of relevance into some of the work that Thibault was speaking about, but perhaps not in the small impact parameter case. So what I mean here by the ultra-relativistic problem, of course, is that in the center of mass frame, the energy of the space-time is dominated by the kinetic energy of these black holes. So the gamma factors here are very, very large. So most of the energy is in kinetic energy. And actually, if you take the infinite boost limit, so then you have to scale the masses to zero, such as this product of m times gamma is finite. Then you actually, so what in the finite boost limit become these sort of Lorentz contracted sort of Coulomb wavefronts that are advected with the black holes in the center of mass frame actually become plane fronted gravitational waves, the so-called Eichelberg-Sexel gravitational shock waves. And I'd say very little qualitatively for this small impact parameter range is known except for the head-on collision case when B is equal to zero. And here's just an example of a simulation. This was work with Will East, where we had where we actually didn't have black holes being the source of these plane waves. But as I mentioned during the text, well, I didn't say it in words, but one interesting thing about this ultra-relativistic limit is the source of the gravitational, these almost impulsive gravitational waves shouldn't matter. They can be black holes, they can be, like in this animation that I'll show you, actually null dust particles. And that's actually why you can, if you're sufficiently above the Planck scale, you don't need quantum gravity. It's purely a classical calculation because of this conjecture that matter doesn't matter. This is just an interesting animation showing the head-on collision case. These plane fronts collided, they formed this black hole in the center, and now the gravitational waves that were formed are sort of circling around the black hole. And incidentally, they're circling around at the dominant quasi-normal mode frequency. So this is sort of a very geometric picture that shows you like where the dominant quasi-normal mode frequency comes from. It's just geometric. That's a geometric property of the black hole. Okay, so what are the open questions? One, is cosmic censorship always satisfied with these small impact parameters? We know it is for the head-on collision case. In quasi-circular sort of astrophysical in spirals it is. But again, it's kind of surprising that cosmic censorship should be satisfied, in some of these most wild storms of space-time dynamics, as Kip puts it. If it is possible to violate it in the binary problem, I suspect it will be in this ultra-relativistic limit, probably with some fine-tuned impact parameters, or there might be a range of impact parameters. Of course, if it is violated, at the point that it's violated, we don't know what's going to happen to the future. We need quantum gravity. If it's satisfied, then there are, perhaps then are the more interesting open questions, because then in principle, we could answer this with classical gravity. So one is the end state always either just one or two black holes? So one black hole in the head-on collision case, very large impact parameters, it's going to be two black holes. But what happens in this intermediate case? And as I explain a little bit more, perhaps it will become apparent why I think that there might be more. What is the maximum energy and what is the maximum angular momentum that can be radiated? The back of the envelope suggests it might be close to 100% energy. You might be able to form close to extremal black holes. But what are those numbers? And if they're not, if they don't saturate the bounds, what are the numbers? And actually, as I mentioned, I'm more interested in the qualitative properties. So it's really not that those numbers that are going to be that interesting, but if they turn out to be either they saturate the bounds or there's some finite value, I think the interesting question is going to be, what was the dynamics that led to that particular number or those particular numbers? And perhaps to reframe it, I think the key question in this regard is, if we look at the threshold, impact parameter between one black hole as a final state and two black holes, perhaps more. So we tune the impact parameter to that threshold. What is the nature of that threshold? And now again, just going into the regime of wild speculation, but I think like this is kind of motivated by work that Amadi and Veneziano and collaborators did sort of, and so to sort of describe what happens in a large but finite collision case. So what is actually going on in these ultra-relativistic interactions? So again, you've got most of the space-time energies and kinetic energy. And what a sort of a Lorentz contracted Coulomb field essentially does is it acts as a very strong gravitational lens. So the question is, how does one of these strong gravitational lenses lens the other lens and vice versa? And what it seems to be is that, you know, when they interact initially, some fraction, and for small impact parameters, probably most of the kinetic energy is converted to gravitational radiation. It's very efficient, and it's highly beamed, but it also gets focused down. So in some sense, what this sort of suggests is after this initial interaction, the black holes have kind of separated their, or the gravitational waves have separated themselves from the seeds of these, of the energy of the space-time, and you now have two clouds of collapsing gravitational wave energy. And that suggests then this really becomes, after this initial interaction, not so much a scattering problem anymore, but a gravitational collapse problem. And if that's the case, then one would expect that this threshold is going to be a critical solution in the sense of chop tuic, of critical phenomena. And if that is the case, then by fine-tuning this impact parameter, because this critical solution is expected to be self-similar, and actually we don't know what the gravitational wave critical solution is exactly, but we expect it to be self-similar, then we should be able to radiate 100% of the energy at threshold. But then, you know, this also goes with this matter does not matter. You know, we have these two little black holes. Imagine two black holes as the sources. They're arbitrarily small, you know, in terms of their rest mass relative to the total mass. Now they've created these huge clouds of gravitational wave energy, but now they've kind of been liberated from, you know, the space-time. Are they going to stick around in this collapsing space-time, or could they escape? If they can somehow escape, then this collapsing cloud could form a black hole and you'd have two black holes moving apart. So that could be a case where there's a three black hole end state. On the other hand, the strong focusing argument suggests that perhaps that one to two black hole threshold is actually not a critical collapse threshold, but instead it's a threshold between one large black hole, and yes, say a macroscopic, but macroscopic relative to the initial rest masses, or two large macroscopic black holes. So it's a one to two black hole threshold. And then there are arguments and work by various people that suggests that, yeah, even though perhaps 100% of the kinetic energy is converted to gravitational waves, most or half of it will essentially be trapped by either the single black hole or the two black holes. And the further that you make the impact parameter wavefare away from that, the less efficient this conversion from kinetic to gravitational wave energy would be. And that suggests that this would be the maximum and would be about 50% of the energy radiated. It's not quite so clear what that would imply for the angular momentum of the remnant. On the other hand, if this one to two threshold is not a critical threshold, but it is still gravitational collapse, which is doing it, that means that some further impact parameter around these now two separately collapsing clouds, there will be chop tuic like critical behavior, presumably. And in that case, in the same arguments as of the previous thing might hold. And you know, if these two little black holes then separate from the critical solution, that could be an example where there's a four black hole end state. And the two collapsing clouds and these two little black holes that manage to escape. And of course, you know, that would, you know, just in taking this to the, what it would imply for superplug scale scattering. Again, it doesn't matter there was fundamental particles or black holes, but it suggests that the possible end states might be more interesting, not just a single black hole, which, you know, if you're close to the Planck threshold will quickly Hawking evaporate, but you could have two unbound particles or two black holes and unbound particles. Again, all of this is just wild speculation, but again, these are open questions, and I think there's a lot of interesting physics here, even if it might not be astrophysically or experimentally relevant. But to conclude, you know, I think, you know, the last few decades have seen a significant progress in our understanding of the dynamics of black holes as governed by general relativity. As both Alessandra and Thibault mentioned, with respect to sort of astrophysical sources of gravitational waves, you know, perhaps these qualitative questions have been answered, but the frontier is now accuracy and getting the relevant precision to actually take advantage of some of these, you know, almost astonishing experiments that might come up. Well, not that LIGO isn't astonishing, but for example, that 3G might see 15, 09, 17 like black holes throughout the observable universe is just mind-boggling. But to be able to take advantage of that, we really need precision. And there's going to be a lot of work both numerically and analytically to get there. However, right now, as what my talk is focused on, there are some interesting areas of sort of parameter space or the theory space where there are still unanswered questions, and also with the interior structure, which I didn't mention. And of course, this is not going to be as relevant. You know, if there was some observational signal, it would be much more relevant. But I think it's interesting enough that it's worth some fraction of the community's effort to explore. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Franz. Now I request Professor Tukolsky to give his talk.
Okay, can you see the slides?
Yes, we can see the slides.
Great, okay. Is that better?
Yeah, that's better, yeah.
Okay, great. All right, so my talk is going to be a slightly different flavor from the previous ones. I'm going to be focusing on some computational questions. And, in the past decades, computational physics has been applied, especially in astrophysics, to many different kinds of examples. And I like this cartoon by Harris. It says it's sick of doing things like inventories and payrolls. It wants to make some breakthroughs in astrophysics. And that's my feeling too. And we've already seen this example several times. This is from the detection paper, the first detection paper by the LIGO collaboration. And in the top panel, you see the strain signal that was measured in the detector. And on the right-hand side, the signal from Hanford, the red one, has been superposed on the signal at Livingston. And you don't have to do any fancy data analysis to see by eye that these things match up. That's how we know that this was a extraterrestrial event. It wasn't people slamming car doors in the parking lot simultaneously two places 2,000 miles apart. Below that is the comparison. So the gray signal is the detected signal with a bit of smoothing done, and the width of that shows the uncertainty of the measurement. And then superposed on that is a numerical waveform from our collaboration. And you can see that, again, without any fancy data analysis, it looks like a very good match. So that's what tells us that the signal came from black holes, because the numerical simulation was done by choosing masses and spins that would give this fit. And we know, therefore, using general relativity, that it was black holes. All right, so that sounds great. But now I have to let you in on a dirty secret. For the past 60 years or so, the dominant algorithm that's been used in all fields to solve the underlying partial differential equations numerically is essentially unchanged. It's as if we've made no progress. And this goes by different names, finite differencing or finite volume methods, but this is what basically just about everybody solving these problems has used this particular technique. The first stirrings that maybe we should be thinking, stretching our minds about other methods, came in other fields. It came in mainly in terrestrial hydrodynamics. But we're interested in Einstein's equations. And the key thing about Einstein's equations, if you're purely, you know, no matter in the problem, just the vacuum Einstein's equations, the solutions are smooth, right? We're assuming we're solving them in the observable part of the space-time away from singularities, and you're not choosing crazy coordinates that have shock waves in them. So that suggests that we should use higher order numerical methods, right? If you think of an underlying Taylor series approximation to the solution, if the solution is smooth, your Taylor series goes on forever, and you should adapt a numerical method to represent all those higher order pieces in your approximation. And that will give you a very efficient way of solving the equation. So I'm not going to go into the details of it. I mean, this is meant to show the difference. The first line is supposed to show finite differencing. So you have some numerical grid represented by the dots. And then by combining function values at those dots, you know, f of x plus h minus f of x divided by h approximates the derivative. And then you can use more and more points, 2h apart, 3h apart, and so on, to get a higher order approximation. And the problem comes when you run into the boundary, either a physical boundary on the left-hand side, or if you have two neighboring subdomains of your regime that you've put on a parallel computer on different processors, then there's a boundary where they have to talk to each other. The finite difference methods run into problems. You can't easily go to high order. One way around this is to use these spectral methods, which I've sort of represented below with an unequally spaced grid, where you use all the interior points in a particular subdomain to get a high order approximation to the solution. And the key point is that a spectral approximation, as you add more and more grid points, converges exponentially fast for a smooth solution, right? Faster than any polynomial, which is what finite difference techniques do. And so this is why, when we first started thinking about really trying to get good solutions for Einstein's equations numerically, it was this sort of information from hydrodynamics that suggested one should use spectral methods. Now, the problem is, if you want to simulate neutron stars, now you have matter, you have fluids, they're smashing to each other, you get shock waves. Neutron stars are stars, they have surfaces. These are discontinuities. And spectral methods don't work well when you have discontinuities, you get Gibbs phenomena. And we would like to do not just black hole physics, but we're going to learn a lot about the universe from neutron star physics as well, when two neutron stars collide, or when a neutron star and a black hole collide. And we're in this era that's called multi-messenger astronomy, where we see these events, not just with gravitational waves, but also with throughout the electromagnetic spectrum, and learn all kinds of things about nuclear physics, about production of heavy elements, all kinds of interesting information. So as we look to the future, what are the challenges for our field? Well, for the binary black hole codes, as we've heard, the LIGO signal-to-noise ratio continues to improve. We're looking forward to a new generation of detectors, the ground-based ones, Cosmic Explorer, the Einstein Telescope, and then going to space detectors like LISA, where the signal-to-noise ratio will be more than 100 times probably, for collision of supermassive black holes, more than 100 times greater than even LIGO at its design sensitivity, which is still a few years away. So, we need higher accuracy if we're going to get the full benefit of these precision experiments. But the spectral methods that are very good now and adequate for LIGO's needs do not scale. We won't be able to make use of the next generation of supercomputers. to get accuracies, for example, for, let's take the example of Lisa. So we'll have the city, we'll be in the situation where, you know, we'll spend billions of dollars on the experiment, and then, you know, for lack of a few million dollars to support some black hole theorists doing these calculations, we won't be able to say, to extract all the science, to say whether in fact there are deviations from general relativity in some very accurate Lisa system. So this is something which we really do need to be thinking about now. It's even worse for neutron stars. Even today, the accuracy of the neutron star simulations is not really adequate to the job. If we really want to know, just before the merger of two neutron stars, if we look at that gravitational wave signal, can we see evidence for the tidal deformation? And how does it vary as we vary the equation of state? It's very iffy whether the numerical accuracy of these calculations is sufficient. And once again, the current methods, these finite difference methods, will not work. They will not be able to take advantage of the next generation of supercomputers. And there are lots of reasons why this is true. I spoke about this, the non-smoothness of the solutions, multiple time scales, the geometry changes. But then also we have multi-physics. We want to solve not only Einstein's equations, we have the hydrodynamics, we want to put in magnetic fields, neutrinos. All of these things make it difficult for the various pieces of the computer code. You're sort of limited by the slowest piece of the calculation. Everything else has to wait to do that. So we have one proposed solution. Again, it's not something that we invented. It comes again mainly from applied mathematicians in the terrestrial hydrodynamics community. It's something called the discontinuous Galerkin algorithm, DG. You don't have to know what it is. It's a kind of a hybrid between spectral methods. It has some of the advantages of spectral methods and the advantages of finite difference methods for handling shocks. I'm not claiming this is the only way forward, but it's certainly a good candidate. So we're working on a new computer code. We had SPEC was our original spectral Einstein code. So SPECTRE is the new code. And so it has two key ingredients. One is this DG algorithm, which has not been used before in computational astrophysics, let alone in numerical relativity, but also it's designed to take advantage of machines which will have millions of CPUs, right? So a beginning graduate student today, by the time they graduate, they could log on to a national supercomputer and have access to a million cores. I'm pretty sure that that's on the horizon. I couldn't find a nice picture of a chip with even, you know, 10,000 cores. Here's one from 2012. If you look at the bottom left there, it says PU0. That's processing unit number zero. And then if you go round clockwise on the bottom right, you'll see PU17. So there's 17 processors here. One of them is used for input and output, so that leaves, sorry, there are 18 processes starting at zero. So that leaves you with 17. And this is advertised as a machine with 16 useful cores. And I'll leave you to think about why it actually has 17, but is advertised to only have 16. You can ask later if you can't figure that out. Anyway, that's what's coming up. So why is it so hard to run current codes on a million processes? So currently, the way we parallelize is we divide up our domain, you know, the interior of the neutron star and the exterior where the gravitational waves travel, into little subdomains. We assign each subdomain to its own CPU. And then we use a very standard software package, MPI, which passes the messages back and forth. And we have this problem then that the load is unbalanced, that we have to wait for the slowest processor to finish its computation. Maybe it's finding an apparent horizon, while the piece that's propagating the gravitational waves away, that's already finished its little time step and it's waiting. Even the communication at these boundaries between the cells, that's a very slow process compared with doing arithmetic on the chips. So how are we going to get around that problem? Everyone is using this MPI method. We have to change the way we parallelize our computer algorithms. We have to use what's called task-based parallelism. So the top half of this diagram is a sort of a figure to show the conventional way we parallelize. So we can think of our algorithm as having a bunch of tasks, you know, compute the right-hand side of the evolution equation for the Einstein for the metric. You know, do that arithmetic. Get information from my neighbor about, you know, some flux of energy and momentum that has to be added to the piece in the volume. Look for an apparent horizon, propagate some neutrino, all kinds of tasks that make up the algorithm. And the idea is that as time goes on to the right, some of these tasks finish earlier than others. But before you can take the next time step, you have to wait for the slowest one to finish. In task-based parallelization, you put all the tasks into a queue, and then you have a pool of available CPUs. And every time one of them finishes a task, it gets sort of popped off the stack, and you start up the next task that's ready to be executed. So the idea is you're always keeping the machine busy. All million cores are doing some useful piece of the algorithm. And if you can get this to work, this has the hope of taking advantage of the next generation of machines. So here's a simple example. This is a relativistic magnetohydrodynamics code. That the part of the spectra, it was a test case, simple case of an analytically known vortex. And so time is moving to the right. And then what's vertically is sort of the percentage utilization of all the cores in the machine. And the color is different tasks, different pieces of the algorithm. So you don't have to even try to decipher the legend of what the tasks are, but the white is idle, right? So you see at the beginning, as the program starts up, is some white. That blue piece there is the initialization, and then the evolution starts. And then, you know, it's dominated by this red and this greenish colored tasks. Those are computing the right-hand sides and sending fluxes to neighbors. The black at the top is the overhead of the task management software, right? It's a very complicated bookkeeping device to keep track of everything. But then you can see as you go along, sort of more than 90% of the machine is being used to do this. And then at the end, we only did 10 time steps here. You can see the white as the cores become idle and you end up, you've completed everything. So in principle, we know how to do this. And the question is, can we get this to work for the full Einstein equations, and then for the full Einstein equations with magnetic fields and nuclear physics and all the stuff that will make multi-messenger astronomy work. And so here's an example, a more challenging one. This is a movie of the Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. So this is a standard test case that we always do. So it's this instability occurs when you have a dense layer of material, say moving in one direction, and then a lighter fluid moving in the opposite direction. In this case, I'm going to have the lighter fluid both above and below. So there's no gravity in this problem, it's just the flows. And what happens at the interface is you get an instability, and you can see these curls of sort of vortices being produced. And the challenge in this is to resolve all the fine scale structure. And the little boxes that you can see are where we're using, so in the center here, the standard DG algorithm is being used. We're getting a high order solution. But in order to resolve this fine structure where there are discontinuities, the little boxes show a new algorithm being used that was developed as part of the thesis by my former graduate student, Niels Deppe, to be able to resolve those things. And if you didn't do that, all of that structure gets smeared out numerically. And when two neutron stars have been orbiting each other and they collide sort of shearing the surfaces. And this instability plays a crucial role in figuring out what happens to the remnant. Okay, so just to summarize, the way I would say it is, after 60 years of finite differencing doing the same thing, it really is time for us as a field to move on. We can't keep our heads in the sand, keep doing the same old thing, and then suddenly wake up tomorrow and realize there are these big machines out there and we can't take advantage of them. Algorithms like this DG method are high order and they're local, they're confined. They only talk to nearest neighbors. They only need information from the nearest neighbors. Whereas standard finite difference methods, to make them higher order, you need to talk to your next to nearest neighbor, and it's very slow and doesn't scale very well. And then this question of being able to resolve the fine structure and the discontinuities in these high order methods. The technical name for that is using a limiter. It limits the Gibbs phenomenon. And the standard things that are in the literature are very bad. They don't work especially for relativistic cases. And so this reminds me that I really want to echo what the other speakers have said. It's very flattering to be awarded something as prestigious as the Dirac Medal, and I'm very honored to be one of the recipients this year. But science is never done in a vacuum. And I want to acknowledge, in this example, it was my graduate student who played a key role, but just in general, all the great graduate students and postdocs that I've been privileged to work with have really been the people on whom this huge enterprise really rests. Just to encourage people who are interested in looking at this, this code is open source. You can go there and download it right after the ceremony today, and you can run the test problems, read the documentation, and get involved. Thank you very much.
And thank you very much for these very interesting talks by the medalist. Now we have time for some questions. Okay, this one, Paolo.
Thanks. Actually, I'm reading a question from somebody attending on Zoom. The question is that whether there are numerical methods I don't know for which, maybe for Pretorius, are there any numerical methods to approximately solve Einstein's equations very close to the singularities?
So in principle, the various methods that people have developed will work, at least from a numerical perspective, you know, whether it's finite difference or pseudo-spectral. The problem approaching the singularity, I think, is largely one of choosing the correct coordinate system, the correct gauge, or if you will, the dynamical coordinates that get you close enough to the singularity where you can answer the questions that you're interested in. And for example, again, the question about what the singularity is in a black hole formed from gravitational collapse, you know, one of the big questions is, is it sort of, there's probably some combination, but is there sort of like a BKL type behavior approaching a certain region, like in so-called cosmological singularities? There must at least be a piece that's sort of a null kind of singularity, like in the Cauchy horizon, the blue sheet instability. But then to get to that, especially if we know that there is a piece that's associated with the Cauchy horizon, we have to evolve the entire infinity of the exterior space before we can get there. So the challenge is coming up with a time slicing that goes through infinity on the outside, doesn't run too fast and fall into a BKL singularity on the interior, and sort of just nicely sidles up to what's going on. And in spherical symmetry, so with Risen and Nordstrom, people have been able to do that. You can actually, it's pretty straightforward. You essentially need to come up with a Penrose diagram. And you can do that in spherical symmetry, but beyond spherical symmetry, there's not been much success. So I think that's the big problem, finding a dynamical coordinate system to get close enough to the interesting part of the space-time.
Any other question? Okay, there is one question in the back there.
So, Professor Thibault, Damour, now you have shown several approximations. I mean, it's a series of that represents quantity that is being calculated. Are we sure that these series are converging? I mean, looking at the coefficients, the coefficients look very strange.
So actually we know they are not converging from a general theorem of Demetrios-Christodoulou, but approximately they have a radius of convergence so that resummation methods, even if they are not converging and they are asymptotic, one can boost their validity, the domain validity. And from the practical point of view, it's not so important whether they converge or not, okay? Like in QFT, where they are known not to converge, and using PADE representations can improve NNLO quantities.
But then how many terms you think would be necessary that you will be kind of sure that the next term will not spoil the previous?
So indeed, if one had only post-Newtonian information, probably it would be impossible to decide this. We are in the lucky situation where we can compare to numerical data. Then when you combine the two, usually you can, with good physicist confidence, know when some resummed analytical expression is accurate, 2, 3, 4 digits. Now, if in the long term one needs phase accuracy of 10 minus 4, 10 minus 5, the question you are asking will become important. And for LISA type physics, for instance, Eanna Flanagan and others have emphasized that you cross some resonances and then you lose accuracy a lot, okay? So I don't want at all to exclude your question and saying we understand everything, okay? It's a research problem and everybody is alert to the fact that, and it's good, yeah, to know that we don't know and that these theories are delicate. like Poincaré said, you know, Poincaré was motivated by the n-body problem. When he got a prize for having proven a theorem, then he realized the theorem was wrong because somebody told him there was a mistake in there. And then he understood that we enter very delicate areas of mathematics.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, there is one more question there.
There was some discussion by Professor Buonanno on the possibility of gravitational waves from supermassive black holes. Was this from mergers? If yes, from merger of two supermassive black holes? And if yes, how likely is for two supermassive black holes to find each other, form a binary, and then merge?
Yeah, I'm not sure I understood the question. So the question is, what are the perspective to see gravitational wave from supermassive black hole binaries?
What process creates this gravitational wave? Merger or something?
Oh, it's if you want, it's similar to the same. It's the same process for stellar mass binary black holes. So you have black holes, million solar masses originally at the core of the galaxies, then they end up in a bound state, so they start to spiral in around each other, and then we get the signal. In one of the plots I was showing, in 1 year even, depending on the masses, we might see the signal for an entire year, so the in spiral part, and then when they merge with each other, and then they're in down. So we will see the whole process, depending on the masses of the supermassive black holes.
So both of the members of the binary are supermassive black holes? And
see, both of them are, these are sources for LISA, however, for the detector in space, because are signals in the millihertz or around the millihertz. They will already be merged at the frequency of LIGO and vehicle, so we don't see them with LIGO and vehicle.
Thank you.
Any other question, the audience? There is, okay, thank you.
I'm Professor Lukin from Ukraine. I'm visiting scientist here to the moment. Thank you very much for very, very exciting presentations. And the general question, the Einstein theory is based on hypothesis of space-time continuum. All the solutions which I heard you talking today about, you applied the finite difference methods, but assumed that the space-time is continuum. But in the, I think it, Professor Damour mentioned the super Planck scale, then matter is matter or non-matter. But then my question, do you think that investigation of such singularities like black holes and what they are generating the waves may be, to which extent, to which scale this space-time continuum is applicable, or it's maybe the, you can point at the scale where we should consider a discrete model or something like this. Yeah, thank you.
Alas, I'm afraid, and Atish,
so please go ahead.
Answer. We were discussing this, is that from the theoretical physics point of view, one would need to have some modification of Einstein's theory at kilometer scales to see something in LIGO Virgo. And even the most optimistic way of saying there could be something beyond gravity, I mean, beyond Einstein gravity, two derivatives, is that maybe at the micron level, you could have something which will not be seen by LIGO-Virgo. So I think, alas, LIGO-Virgo will not give us information about what happens on in the UV on very small scales, which are reasonably expected from theoretical physics.
Solution. Young people.
Yes.
Studying very more details and algorithms and physics in this area, maybe you face some fundamental contradictions which inspire to think on modification. So my question was on that.
Modified gravity, you mean?
It modified, for young people who are here.
Yes, I think you have already answered. Thibault, you want to continue or? No, I think this is a great, LIGO, Virgo is very great laboratory to learn about astrophysics and on, but I think it does not access the scales where the you have to go, let's say, higher derivative terms and beyond the Einstein-Hilbert action or quantum gravity effects. I think that's where you might see the discreteness. And I don't think accesses that region.
I'm on your side. I thought just maybe picked up something. I don't know.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other? Comment. Sorry. Franz, please go ahead.
Yeah, I should say that people are trying to think sort of outside the box and come up with more outrageous suggestions where you might get away from this sort of very small scale. Perhaps you can, I can say, like, you know, for example, fuzzballs and things like that. But then also, like what Alessandra mentioned in the talk, that, you know, despite the, even if we don't anticipate that, there's a lot of work trying to use gravitational wave detections to actually measure what's out there, like these post-Newtonian coefficients, constraining them to be zero. Like if nothing unusual happens, like what you might suggest, the constraints are just going to get stronger. But LIGO is still very actively looking for something. And perhaps nature surprises our intuition and gives us something that's going to show up at the kilometer scale. And you know, people should be thinking about that. I definitely agree. Young people should be thinking about these things. And LIGO is looking for anomalies.
Alessandro, you want to comment maybe on possibilities of using LIGO for going beyond?
Well, I think I was going to say basically what Franz already said. I think people are who are trying to do this test, they consider modified theories of general relativity in which actually the scale is not the Planck scale, but they are open to the possibility that the scale could be of the order of kilometers. And are trying just to see whether the gravitational wave observation can say something about in that case. Mm-hmm. Now, perhaps theoretically, this is, hard to motivate, but I think one has to be open-minded.
Yeah, open-minded and place experimental bounds on these parameters. That certainly is a very important thing to do. Sol, do you want to comment on this question or?
I will just say that one of the challenges in trying to, even with the current experiment, to try to set bounds on these things is we don't really have a good framework. What does it mean? You know, if I measure some parameter in a waveform model and I put a bound on it, well, does that mean that certain theories are actually ruled out? We don't have a good theory of theories. We have some, it's not that there's been no work in this. There's certainly, is work by, Francis thought about these things and other people too. But so the one issue is we don't have a good way to associate any potential bounds that we find with a class of theories. And then second of all, if you have a favorite theory which you think is going to make you famous because you're going to prove Einstein was wrong, you need to be able to calculate what the waveforms are, what LIGO should see in your theory. And most theories that theorists have come up with, actually you can't do that calculation. They are ill-posed in a mathematical sense. There's no Cauchy evolution problem that you can use to actually calculate. So people are, in the old days before LIGO, people could get away with coming up with some modified theory, checking that it agreed with the solar system tests of general relativity, and then saying, see, you know, I'm as smart as Einstein. I have a, you know, an equally good theory. Well, you can't get away with that today. Thanks to LIGO, you have to be able to calculate what LIGO sees. And if you can't do that, your theory is not complete. So I think that these are challenges that people tend to not think about when asking about alternative theories of gravity.
Alessandra, you want to comment?
Yeah. I fully agree with Saul. I just wanted to add that on one side, people are doing, so the kind of bounds that, for example, I was showing are more to be considered like a null test, in the sense it's not the absolute value of the bound that is really important. It's more to see how the bound would improve over time, just to show that one has more sensitivity. But I fully agree that one should actually do calculations, including numerical calculation, in beyond GR theories. And this is very hard because many of them are not well posed. But there are, you know, techniques, method that people are trying to suggest to do that. So there is a lot of work, actually all the work that we have done for GR at some point should be extended to non-GR theories, which is immense.
Okay. Kip, do you want to add something? Do you have some thoughts on how future research in this field could, you know, take us beyond?
No concrete thoughts beyond my enthusiasm that this field is just taking off so marvelously, thanks both to the theoretical work, the computational work, and the observations. I'm just so enthusiastic about the future, and I really have nothing more to say than that.
Okay. I think if there are no further questions, I think let's thank all the speakers for a wonderful early. We all know that this is a very exciting field, which is just beginning to bloom. And thank you very much for very inspiring talks. Thank you very much, Saul, for joining us remotely, and Kip for being here with us and for this marvelous introduction to this work. I wish that both of you could join us for a nice Italian dinner, but maybe next time. And I would like to also announce that please follow me after this. We are going to inaugurate the Dirac exhibition. So you are the stars of the, we are starting at the ICTP, this new Dirac exhibit of the Dirac medalist. And today is the inauguration. So please, all of you are requested to follow me. And you can take your time and look at the Dirac medalist since the beginning. So with this, this session is closed, but we will go to the Dirac stairs. Thank you. Thank you.